Good morning, students. Hope all of you are fit and fine. Let us start off with our continue with our history lesson. We were on chapter 4, History of Indian Arts, and today we will be continuing that lesson. I will be posting 2 to 3 videos, one after the other, and also I'll be sharing with you a PDF wherein you will have the notes for this particular chapter along with a few extra questions. We have already completed a part of the chapter, and one point which remained earlier was the classical styles of painting. This portion we had not dealt with. Here a concept map also is coming up, and I am going to share this concept map with you. First, let us revise the chapter a little bit. We discussed what is art, what are the two different types of art forms. Here you have art is a natural human instinct, and man wants to share his experience, wisdom, and also his emotions. And whatever beautiful creation it results in, that is acknowledged as art. Then we discussed the two different artistic creations, visual arts and performing arts, and we have discussed in detail about visual arts, which is also called as Drik Kala. Painting and sculpture come up under Drik Kala. Okay, so painting and sculpture, we have discussed a lot about painting and sculpture, and one point in that particular aspect remained. That is what we are going to discuss today. Classical styles of painting. You can see on the screen, classical styles of painting. The ancient texts in India have explained the various aspects of arts in great detail. And all these arts together are mentioned in these texts. There are 64 arts mentioned. Art of painting is described in the Indian text, ancient Indian text, as Alekhyam or Alekhya Vidya. And it is said to have 6 main aspects. This is a concept map, children. And shadange, shad means 6, and there are 6 aspects which have to be given importance to when a particular painting is being painted. Okay, and you also would have experienced this when your drawing teacher asks you to put up a still life or a figure drawing. How should be the background, how there must be a proportionate depiction of all the features and of an image. The expressions matter a lot. If a boy is going to be sad, the sad expression must come up on his face. Someone is happy, then that expression must come up. Then a resemblance to reality. So let us talk about the 6 aspects of painting. I'll be sharing with you a concept map. Just have a look at it, the concept map. Where you have the 6 main aspects of classical styles of painting, which have been mentioned by scholars. These include the Agama texts of various religious texts. These are given in the Puranas and Vastu Shastra. And they also explain, they are included in the art of painting and sculpting, especially in the context of temple architecture. And the 6 aspects are Rupa Veda, different shapes and forms. Then Pramana, proportionate depiction of various features of an image, limbs especially. The face should be proportionate to the body. So all these aspects are considered. Bhava, that is expressions. Lavanya, yojana, that is aesthetics. Sadrushtaya, a resemblance to reality. And Varnika bhaga, color composition. Very bright color should be used only in certain contexts. Dark colors are used in certain other, to depict certain other characters or certain other aspects. So all these 6 points, when they're taken into consideration, the result is a beautiful painting or a beautiful sculpture. Let us continue. Going back to the text, we have, yes, in the textbook here, now we'll be dealing with the next aspect, that is sculptural art. Okay. textbook page. I am sharing the textbook page with you. Let us come to the sculptural art. Sculptors are three-dimensional figures, children, and they include images, statues and pots, objects with artistic embellishments. Embellishment is decorations. For creating sculptures, either the material which is used is rock, metal or clay. So statues, images, pots and objects which are decorated, and these are made out of rock, metal or clay. And rock sculptures, they are made by carving. A chisel is used by a sculptor. Metal sculptures are made with the help of molds. For example, your Ganpati idols, when they are made, or any gods, goddess sculptures, when they are made, their molds are used. Clay sculptures are either directly made with hands. For example, a Ganpati figure, you can make it directly with your hands, or if it's a very big idol, molds are used. So sculptural art becomes very, very important. And a very beautiful example of sculptural art is the Kailasa temple at Verul, which is actually made out of a single, carved out of a single rock. Mono means single, monolithic sculpture. And it's a wonder, it's a World Heritage Site, and it is present in Aurangabad, and people go and visit this particular World Heritage Site. It is in Maharashtra, so we need to be very proud of the very fact that we have a very, very important sculptural art, example of a Indian sculptural art, which is coming up under World Heritage Site. I'll share some pictures of the Kailasa temple. Again, under sculptural art, you have lion capital of the Ashokan pillar, which is found at Sarnath, which is a national emblem of India. The four lions, and we can actually see on the surface, three lions can be directly seen, and the fourth one is just behind. And it is the included as a national capital, national emblem of India. So you find them on important documents, then currency notes, stamp papers, etc. Okay. When you talk about sculptural art, again, you have the pictures of Bailpola. On the right side, you can see during this Bailpola festival, you have small figures of the bull, which is again very important as India being an agricultural country. The bulls, oxen, they are worshipped. The farmers express their gratitude to these animals for helping them out in the agricultural activity. Similarly, you have the figures of Goddess Lakshmi, mask of Gauri. Then also you have virgals. Virgals are memorial stones which are built to honor or pay a tribute to those soldiers or warriors who have become martyrs and who have sacrificed their lives during the time of battles. So sculptural art, when you talk about it, we also have Harappan seals. Let's go back to the previous slide, children. There you have the Harappan seal, where you have some kind of, it's made out of clay or terracotta, and there is some kind of script, and this script has not yet been deciphered. But the moment we come to know more about the script, we'll get a lot of other information about the Harappan culture. You also have the Sanchi Stupa, which is again a very beautiful example of sculptural art. Let's go ahead. The Sarnath pillar, where you have again the lions and the beautiful pillar. Then you have the birds, Satyameva Jayate, a horse and a bull, and the Ashoka Chakra in the middle. Okay, this is the national emblem of India. Here again, you have pictures of Virgal, children, memorials which have been erected at different places. Then you have all these on the right, extreme right hand side. You can see the seals of the Harappan culture. These seals have been found in different places, and that connects the different sites of the ancient Indian Harappan civilization or Harappan culture. There is a YouTube link where you can get more information about the Sanchi Stupa. This link I'll forward to you after we finish with the video along with the notes. Okay. Let's see the beautiful picture of the Kailasa temple at Verul. They are part of the Ellora caves, Ajanta and Ellora caves. So here, Kailasa temple comes with the group of Ellora caves. You will find that as we discussed, it is the wonderful or unique feature is it is made out of a single monolithic rock. So you find they say that this particular, these sculptures were actually engraved starting from the top and then they carved out the base part of the temple. Okay. And the way it has been done, it is actually a wonder. It becomes one of the real wonders in the field of architecture. Okay, let's move ahead. And here is another one picture of the Kailasa temple. And you'll find, see the sculptures of lion, elephants, and all other figures. Now, although this has been this is a World Heritage Site and it is maintained by the UNESCO, still weathering and climatic conditions have influenced the architecture and the sculptural art, and they are slowly breaking up, and though efforts have been made in order to restore them. Again, you have some of the Buddhist stupas. You have the stupa at the stupa which is there in Indonesia, the Borobudur stupa in Indonesia, which is the biggest stupa, the largest stupa. It's very vast. Okay. And most of these stupas are all related to Buddhism. Okay. Let's go back to the textbook a little bit. Here you have again pictures of Virgals, Bharut stupa, and a part of it is actually preserved in Kolkata, Indian Museum at Kolkata. Okay, Virgals, and you have the Bharut stupa. Okay, in the textbook, let's read through a little bit. Now, sculptural art is as old as the ancient art of painting. Here you have a textbook question, children, and there are 4 points. I'll just again share one PPT with you, the one slide of PPT, where I put it down in point form, and so this slide, the question is, write about the folk traditions of sculptural art. Write about the folk traditions of sculptural art. Many points are there, children, in this, and you must be familiar at least with 4 points to complete an answer. This is question number 5, okay, in your board paper. Write about the folk traditions of sculptural art. Sculptural art is very ancient, and it is as ancient as art of painting, dating back to ages. Carving of tools made out of stones. Early Stone Age man, he used to carve out tools made of stone, and that is the beginning of the sculptural art. Hand axe and several other things were made out of stones. The custom of making clay images for rituals have been prevalent in India since Harappan times. So many seals were found, many figures of gods, goddesses were found from the Harappan excavations. Even today you will find the sculptural art in regions like Bengal, Bihar, Gujarat and Rajasthan. What are the examples? Ganesha idols, masks of Gauri, bull figures made during the festival of Bail Pula. Wooden memorials, Virgals. Wooden memorials and Virgals, it is memorial stones. You have seen the pictures of all this. Decorated clay store bins are some of the examples of the folk traditions of sculptural art. All these pictures we have just now seen, and they all come up under what you call as sculptural art. Let's go back to the text, children. Now, so Harappan seal, stone and bronze statues tell, which are 5,000 years old or even older tradition, they talk about the Indian sculptural art. We have sculptural art became famous during the Mauryan period with Ashokan pillars. Then you have the sculptors at Bharut, which are testimonies of the continuous development of sculptural art in India. Sculptural art in India developed a lot, especially during the Mauryan times. And with the development of Buddhism, when stupas were erected at different places, you will find that there was a little more of advancement in the field of sculptural art. Okay, then the largest stupa at Borobudur in Indonesia, it's the largest stupa in the world. You saw the picture of that, dating back to 8th and 9th century. Okay, now let us come to Indian iconography. What is iconography? Let us first define iconography. Iconography is a branch of knowledge which includes everything about making statues of gods and goddesses. Whenever you talk about Indian culture, Indian tradition, Indian religion, you have, especially related to Hinduism, you find lots of images of gods and goddesses made out of clay, rock, metal, etc. So here, iconography, Indian iconography, Gandhara school of art. We know how a school of art emerges when a particular tradition is followed for a long period of time, and there are certain distinct features which are followed, or characteristic features which are followed, it becomes a school of art. So we have the Gandhara school of art. Gandhara is in Afghanistan in the 2nd century common era in Afghanistan and the neighboring regions. The Gandhara school of art came into existence. It had, this particular school had more of the Greek and Persian influence. They had taken points from, they were influenced rather by Greek sculptor and Persian sculptor. The 1st and the 3rd century common era, we have the Kushana period, where you have another school of sculptural art, that is Mathura school of art. And this Mathura school of art laid the foundation of Indian iconography. Let's once again revise. What is Indian iconography? What is iconography? Iconography is a branch of knowledge which includes everything about making the statues of images of gods and goddesses. Kushana kings made use of these images on various deities. They engraved it on their coins. Then during the Gupta period, which is considered to be the golden age of India, again, iconographic rules were formulated. How should the statue be? What should be the metal used? What should be the proportion? Okay. So there was a significant amount of progress made in sculptural art, especially during the Gupta period. Bronze images were developed under the encouragement or patronage of Chola kings. During the 9th and the 13th century, bronze idols of gods and goddesses like Shiva, Parvati, Nataraja, Lakshmi, Vishnu were all made during this period. Now, all these images, which dates back to very olden times, you can find them in museums. Okay. And you have the pictures of all these in archives also. Let's move over to the next point, that is of art and sculpture. Okay. Art and sculpture, there is a very, beautiful combination, because wherever you find temple architecture, you find they're decorated with sculptures. Okay, there are a number of rock cut caves in India, and the tradition of rock cut caves originated in India in the 3rd century common era. The entire composition of a rock cut cave represents a union of architecture and sculptural art. Entrances, the interiors of the carved columns, images are excellent examples of sculptural art. When a temple is being built, in order to decorate it, what decorates it? The sculptures which are there, the paintings which are there on the walls and ceilings, they make it more colorful and decorated. Rock cut caves at Ajanta and Verul in Maharashtra were declared as World Heritage Site. Now see, there is a picture of, in the textbook, cave, Ajanta cave number 19 entrance. You will find that it has a lot of sculpture. Look at the columns, look at the arch, and very intricate designs, and very beautiful work done by the sculptor. Okay, and this has been declared as World Heritage Site in 1983. Now let's continue. You have temple architecture. So temple architecture and sculpture, they go together. Temple architecture. Architecture is basically, what do you mean by the word architecture? When a particular building or something is being constructed with a proper design in mind, then it is included in the word architecture. So temple architecture in India began to develop around 4th century common era. Temples were built during the Gupta period, and these temples only had a very small central room, you can say, which was called as a Garbhagriha, where the important idol was kept, and there would be a veranda, and there would be 4 columns. So this is how the temple architecture began, actually. Small temples were built. But the kings of those times, you know, wanted to show their power, their position, their wealth, the grandeur. And so therefore, they built a lot of temples with beautiful towers. And temple architecture reached its peak during the 8th century common era. Now, one of the examples, we've already seen the Kailasa temple, the Shiva temple at Verul. Then you have during the medieval period, several styles of temple architecture developed in India. So there were sculptors in different parts of India, and different styles of temple architecture came into being. Now, I'll take you to a PPT. I'll show you some pictures of the various styles of temple architecture now. Okay, let's okay, temple architecture. We have two types. There's a tree diagram. Again, this is a concept map. Temple architecture is of two types, Nagara style and Dravidian style. Nagara style is prevalent in North India, and the Dravidian style is the temples of South India. And the Nagara style is also reflected in the Bhumija style of Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra. You will find that most of the temples in Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra, they follow the Nagara style. And a combination of the Nagara style and the Dravidian style is called as the Vesara style. Once again, I repeat, temple architecture, types of temple architecture, two main classifications, Nagara style and Dravidian style. Nagara style is the style from North India. Dravidian style belongs to southern portion of India. And in Madhya Pradesh and in Maharashtra, you have the Bhumija style, which is again, it is more like the Nagara style. But in certain temple architectures, the Nagara style and the Dravidian style, they are both combined. And that is called as the Vesara style. Let's move ahead. And yes, here you have a very beautiful slide on the Nagara style. Look at the beautiful tower which is there above the built over the base of the temple. The right side you have, the left side, whatever you can see, the Nagara style, there are no colors used. Okay. It is more or less, it remains as a stone color, or sometimes one color is used. But whereas the Dravidian style or the South Indian temples, they are more colorful. And sometimes they depict an entire story. And these are very intricately carved out, that sculpture and the temple architecture go very well together. And this took many years. Sometimes this one temple took many, many years to construct. Again, on the left-hand side corner down, you have the Vesara style. Again, you'll see there's a combination where tower is more like the Dravidian style, whereas the base is more like the North Indian style. Okay. And you have the Bhumija style, spire in South India, Sadashiv temple of 1249 Common Era, built by the Hoysala Empire at Nugehalli, Karnataka. These are the examples. Nagara style, Dravidian style, Nagara style North India, Dravidian style South India, Vesara style Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra, and Bhumija style West Madhya Pradesh and Maharashtra, and Vesara style, which is a combination of both Nagara style and Dravidian style. Okay, so students, this video we will stop here. We will continue with the next. I'll continue with the next video, and so we have completed up to temple architecture and types of temple architecture. Temple architecture, we have completed only one point. We will be continuing with the next style of temple architecture related to Maharashtra, and that is the Hemadpanthi style of temple architecture. Okay, so this, we come to the end of this particular video, and next session we will start off with the Hemadpanthi style of temples. Thank you, children.